Frozen. My Journey into the World of Cryonics, Deception, and Death by Larry Johnson with Scott Baldyga. Narrated by William Dufris. Copyright 2009 by Larry Johnson with Scott Baldyga. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Vanguard Press, a member of the Perseus Books Group, and was produced in the year 2009 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Introduction. You're about to hear a really bizarre story. I won't be able to explain all the things my colleagues at Alcor Life Extension Foundation did, or why I made all the decisions I did during the 7 months I worked there. Some of those decisions, including why I first went to work at Alcor, may seem strange to you. As you'll hear, though, I've been an adrenaline junkie most of my life, and the job as clinical director for Alcor promised to be unlike anything I'd ever done before, and never boring for me. Boy, was I right about that. At first, the idea of working at Alcor fit the bill perfectly. Although the important cryobiological research I was promised during my initial job interview never materialized, soon it didn't matter. The more I got to know my colleagues and the history of the place, the more immersed in it I became. Meanwhile, by slowly earning the trust of my eccentric coworkers, I became privy to many company secrets and was promoted to acting chief operating officer. At some point, though, when I began to realize that really dark and possibly illegal things were being done at Alcor, I decided I owed it to everyone, the frozen Alcor patients, their families, the surrounding community, even the hardcore Alcorians, sincerely hoping for another life beyond this one, to document the abuses that were going on under the roof of that strange enterprise. I observed unconscionable environmental and animal experimentation practices. My complaints about apparent OSHA, Occupational Safety and Health Administration, and EPA, Environmental Protection Agency, infractions kept falling on deaf ears. Worse, I soon began hearing persistent rumors about the suspicious, premature deaths of several Alcor members. So I began digging, and have never quit. I'd never before seen myself as a whistleblower, but that does seem to be what I've become. I began copying Alcor documents and, later, recording conversations with my colleagues. Ultimately, I wore a wire every single day of my last 3 months there. I had to do this, and you'll hear why. I'd never imagined myself in that role, but I respect the truth, and people who aren't afraid to speak the truth, even to the powerful. During my time at Alcor, and in the 6 years since I had to flee Scottsdale, maintaining my self-respect by finding the truth and making it widely known had become, next to my wife and family, the most important things in my life. That's why I wanted to write and publish this book. Thank you for listening to it. Larry Johnson, July 1, 2009. Prologue. My wife and I were in the living room, packing frantically, rushing to get out of town, when suddenly there was a thunderous pounding on the door. Beverly started screaming. I ran to the bedroom, grabbed my 9mm Beretta from under the bed, and rushed back to the living room. The banging was so powerful, the molding was breaking off from the wall. They were literally bashing their way in. I inched toward the door. Beverly was on the floor, crying hysterically, her hands over her ears. I put my eye to the peephole, but the door was vibrating too violently for me to see who was there. Shouts came from the other side.
Johnson, you motherfucking traitor! We'll get you, you son of a bitch!
I backed up, aimed my gun at the door, shaking in its hinges, and screamed,
"If you come through that door, I'll put a bullet through your head!"
I meant it. At that moment, I really believed I was going to have to kill someone.
You traitor! We'll kill you! You too, Beverly! You will both die!
The banging stopped. Footsteps ran down the outside stairs. Beverly was crumpled in a heap on the floor, sobbing. I stood, trembling, looking down at my wife. What have I done? Chapter 1. Carnage and Chaos in Sin City. July 5, 2002 was just another day for me as a paramedic in Las Vegas. I awoke at my usual 5 o'clock to the sound of the weatherman announcing that the outside temperature was already 99 degrees. Still feeling the toll of yesterday's 12-hour shift, I knew I was in for another long, hot day. I showered in a flash and was quickly ready to leave home. Careful not to wake my wife, Beverly, I tiptoed outside, walked downstairs into the garage of our apartment building, and said good morning to the other love of my life, my Harley. One of my greatest pleasures is riding my fat boy. Ever since I was 9 years old, I would hop on any kind of motorbike and roar through the desert to recharge my batteries. It was a perfect escape and helped me stay sane. I've always been happy to be left on my own, and there is nothing like the rush of freedom and solitude I feel when I ride. During my early morning rides, whatever was clogging my head would spread out, thin, and be swept away behind me. After cruising some of my favorite desolate desert roads, I chose a route that would take me up Las Vegas Boulevard, the Strip. I hopped off the 215 at the last exit before Interstate 15 down by the airport. There's something eerie about cruising the Strip at 5 or 6 in the morning. Somehow I felt like I was getting away with something, like I wasn't meant to be there. Not at that time, and definitely not alone. At that time of the morning, I might see the occasional hooker or random drunk stumbling along the sidewalk, but Las Vegas Boulevard itself was usually empty. I could cruise quietly or roar straight down its throat, depending on my mood. I was in little danger of getting sideswiped by a tourist in a rented minivan. Of course, the casinos never closed. But at this time of morning, they were at their quietest, slumbering giants shaking themselves awake, stretching open their jaws to swallow up every dollar from every sucker from every other town in America. I could see the sun coming up, while many of the casinos still had their lights on. There wasn't another soul around. I passed Caesar's Palace and saw the spot where 2 months earlier I had jumped on a guy who had attacked a cop, all three of us wrestling for the cop's gun. The guy was out of his mind on sherm, a cigarette or a joint dipped in embalming fluid. The effect of smoking this popular street drug is said to be like that of the powerful stimulant PCP. It was a vicious struggle, but the cop and I eventually subdued him. If he had gotten that gun, I probably would have ended up as no more than a stain on the Caesar's Palace sidewalk. Mount Charleston is a huge chunk of rock that rises out of the sand north of the Strip. This morning it shimmered with the reflection of the rising sun. Spectacular blues, oranges, and a battleship gray were dissolving into a soft purple. Even in the July heat, snow somehow survived on top of Mount Charleston. Whether or not it could be seen from the Strip depended on the previous winter's snowfall, but I had seen it up there myself, year-round, enduring even the desert heat and the protective shadows of the crags and cliffs. I always found that stubborn snow encouraging. The ride was working its magic, as it usually did. I was being washed clean. The aches and pains from the previous day's shift were sliding away. Seeing Mount Charleston in the distance never failed to refresh my spirit. It helped me prepare for whatever stresses the day would present, and there would be stresses. It takes a certain type of person to be a paramedic. I've worked in half a dozen cities in the American Southwest and Texas, but in Las Vegas particularly, I'd witnessed some of the most disturbing human behavior on the planet. I'd had bits of my ear chewed off by crazed drug addicts who broke through their restraints in the back of an ambulance, scraped sick, homeless drunks off scorching asphalt in 110-degree heat, their charred skin sticking to the pavement, mopped high-diving, high-stakes losers off casino sidewalks, talked teenage rape victims off seventh-floor balconies, and run hundreds of calls to neighborhoods in which I otherwise would never have shown my face. More than once, I'd hit the deck when automatic weapon fire sprayed through my ambulance, bullets ripping the air over my head. Gang members usually don't want their rivals to receive medical attention. Somehow, I had always made it through the constant mayhem of shootouts, fistfights, knife fights, and ambulance crashes. It was tough on my body, always carrying heavy gear or even heavier bodies. The emotional strain, though, was worse. Paramedics worked with pain and death every day. We developed mental calluses, but still found ourselves continually surrounded by suffering, sorrow, and heart-wrenching loss. Sometimes I could help. Sometimes I couldn't. Sometimes I saved a life. Sometimes I watched a grown man scream hysterically in the street as his daughter died in his arms. In Las Vegas, I was constantly wading through the seamier side of humanity. On good nights, I'd be stationed outside Caesar's Palace, and tourists would ask me to pose with them for pictures in front of the ambulance, like I was Siegfried or Roy. Mostly, though, I responded to 911 calls in the tougher North Vegas neighborhoods, poor areas with a lot of gang violence that doesn't make it onto the TV news. Sadly, I worked with the worst people at their worst times. We often arrived on a scene before the police. Protocol dictated that we did not rush in alone. It wasn't our responsibility to mix it up with gang members, and we didn't carry weapons. It wasn't easy, though, knowing that a bystander might be hurt and all we could do is park at a safe distance and wait for the cops. I'd scrunch down in my seat in case there were shots fired, roll my window down a crack, and wait for the all clear. In my experience, most paramedics burned out after around 5 years and switched jobs. I was then in my 25th year as a paramedic. It must have been the excitement of not knowing what emergency I could be called to from 1 minute to the next that had kept me in emergency medicine for 5 times longer than the average paramedic. I admit it, I've always been an adrenaline junkie. When I arrived at work that morning of July 5, 2002, I found my 20-something-year-old partner Steve in the back of our ambulance with an IV in his arm, rehydrating himself after a night of 4th of July debauchery. Most paramedics lived hard. 12-hour shifts were followed by late nights and early mornings of nurse chasing down at the emergency room bar just off the strip. We had our own hangout, the Las Vegas emergency medical community's equivalent of Cheers. Steve had a story to tell nearly every morning. He reminded me of myself back in the day. There was a strong bond among paramedics, especially between partners. It was similar to that of firefighters, police, or maybe soldiers on the battlefield. You went through hell together, constantly on the lookout to protect each other. I loved that feeling of community and camaraderie. Watching Steve gobbling saline pills and sucking on an oxygen mask, though, reminded me of just how young I wasn't. Optimistically, we tried to make it to McDonald's for a couple of Egg McMuffins before the daily pandemonium began. But like most mornings, the calls came in as soon as we hit the street. Just another day of carnage and chaos in Sin City. Our third back-to-back morning call involved lugging a 300-pound heart attack victim through the impossibly narrow confines of his mobile home. Struggling with his bulk, I noticed a membership brochure on the man's kitchen table for something called Alcor Life Extension Foundation. Life Extension Foundation? I thought. What's that all about? Later that morning, Steve and I heard the news over the radio in our ambulance. Ted Williams had died. This really upset me. Ted Williams was one of my personal heroes. Even though I had grown up awfully far from Boston, his legendary baseball career had proven to me that with enough hard work and dedication, anything was possible. One of my childhood's prized possessions was a Little League Ted Williams baseball bat. I still have it, a along with my Sears Ted Williams bicycle. Ted Williams? Steve asked. Who's that? Oh, you're kidding, I said. Ted Williams was one of the greatest hitters of all time, not to mention an American war hero. Steve shrugged. I shook my head. Man, am I that old? In December 2002, I began looking for a new job in earnest. After 25 years as a paramedic, I was really burnt out. My wife, Beverly, saw it. As much good as riding my Harley did, as good a shape as I was in, I was still a few years north of 40. I'd always been told I looked young for my age. I'd even been accused of having a boy-next-door quality to me. Those days were behind me now, though. Like an athlete over 40, I was constantly sore. I knew in my bones that it was time to make a change. I also wanted to live closer to my father. My mom and dad had divorced when I was very young. Even before my parents split up, my dad was either gone all day working for the phone company or gone all night working as a pianist. I'd never had an opportunity to be around him much. My father was getting up there in age, and if I was going to change careers, I might as well change cities. Dad was now retired, remarried, and living in Phoenix. Dad's wife was a kind woman named Mary Jane. Unfortunately, she was also very sick and needed a lot of care at home. Dad loved her dearly and stayed by her side day after day. So I began the process of a change in careers. One field I was interested in was biotechnology research. I had to be realistic, though. Adrenaline had been a part of my daily routine for 25 years. How happy would I be sitting in a quiet lab every day watching liquids inside test tubes turn from green to blue? Yeah, I was burnt out from paramedicine, but I still craved excitement. Only now I was searching for intellectual stimulation rather than the peculiar thrill of wrestling with SHRM-crazed felons. My dream job, then, would be an exceptionally interesting biological research position in Phoenix, close to my dad. A tall order, for sure. A few weeks into my job search, I ran across an advertisement on Monster.com looking for a paramedic or nurse to be a team leader for a company researching life extension via the cold temperature sciences. This struck me as interesting. The company was called Alcor Life Extension Foundation. That was the name of the company on the pamphlet I had seen the morning of Ted Williams's death. What a coincidence. I hadn't followed the scandal surrounding Ted Williams's death too closely, but I did remember that there was some family squabbling about his final remains, and I remembered something about him being frozen. I googled Alcor and Ted Williams, and sure enough, it seemed as if Ted Williams had been brought to Alcor. Huh, what were the odds? I felt like the universe was telling me to look into this job. Unlike most job ads, there was a phone number. Maybe they were really anxious to fill the position. I called and spoke to a man named Charles Platt. In what sounded like a distinguished English accent, Charles asked, "Larry, have you heard of cryonics?" "It has something to do with freezing organs for long-term storage, right?" "Well, yes," Charles said. "Alcor is a cold temperature research facility located in the Phoenix suburb of Scottsdale, Arizona." Wow, a research facility outside Phoenix. "We work closely with our sister facility in Rancho Cucamonga, California, called Critical Care Research or 21st Century Medicine," Charles said. "Together we develop and experiment with drugs and freezing procedures to preserve human organs in the hopes of one day reanimating our patients." Reanimating?
"Yes. The goal of cryonics is bringing our patients back to life."
"Oh. Well, Charles, it sounds fascinating, but I'm really more interested in mainstream biological research, like maybe the preservation of organs for transplants." Undaunted, Charles told me that what they were doing at CCR in Rancho Cucamonga was right up my alley then. They were making great strides in cryobiological research, he said.
particularly in freezing and unfreezing kidneys, hearts, livers, and corneas for transplants. This type of research was going to save lives. CCR was also working toward being able to freeze endangered plant species to combat extinction. And one of CCR's scientists was working on an ice-resistant concrete treatment to keep runways and roads bone dry during the worst ice storms. A real life-saving advancement if it worked. I had seen enough road accidents as a paramedic, enough people killed driving in icy conditions, to know how valuable that would be. Plus, Charles told me, he was sure I'd be equally impressed with the groundbreaking work at Alcor itself. I should come to Scottsdale, Charles said. Alcor would fly me out. I could tour the facility and we would discuss Alcor's needs in detail. Right there on the phone, without even having seen my resume, Charles asked what would be a good date for me. That conversation with the distinguished-sounding Mr. Platt sparked my interest. So I decided to go online and research recent work in the cold temperature sciences. What I found was amazing. Much like bold discoveries that have been made in quantum mechanics, advances in the cold temperature sciences were challenging accepted views of reality. The behavior of certain metals at extremely low temperatures contradicted the very laws of physics. At super cold temperatures, scientists were discovering some elements were sliding around without any friction at all. Matter acted in ways it simply shouldn't. I found this fascinating. The practical applications included improved hospital machines, fuel for the space shuttle, food preservation, organ and embryo storage, scalpels that cut without drawing blood, superior fire retardants, and new plans for fusion energy plants. Cryobiologists were even bringing children to the infertile. And as Charles had mentioned, doctors were now able to perform life-saving organ transplants that were previously impossible. Clicking from web page to web page, I learned that cryogenics, a branch of physics, was the study of low temperatures themselves and how they affected materials. Cryobiology was the study of the effects of low temperatures on biological matter or organisms, and cryonics was the application of these cold temperature sciences with the intention of freezing people or animals in the hopes of one day reviving them. It was that reviving bit that was sticking in my craw. I visited Alcor's website. The front page seemed to me heavy on the marketing, like it was meant to entice the average browser to look past the fantastic science fiction aura surrounding cryonics, which at first sure sounded implausible. I decided to cut to the chase and found the webpage that listed Alcor's board of advisors. If they had any legitimate scientists involved, I figured, maybe it wasn't completely far-fetched. Man, was I in for a shock. When I read the credentials of the people on Alcor's list of scientific advisors and conference speakers, I was astounded. They included MIT and UCLA professors, research scientists from UC Berkeley and Cambridge, and JPL, Jet Propulsion Laboratory, and NASA advisors. The ranks of Alcor's scientific advisors included Marvin Minsky of the MIT Media Lab and the MIT Artificial Intelligence Lab, and Ralph Merkel, one of the top people in robotics and nanotechnology research. Stem cell researcher Michael D. West, one of the leading figures in modern biotech, had recently spoken at the Alcor Conference on Extreme Life Extension in November 2002, as had artificial intelligence pioneer Ray Kurzweil, who I read had won the $500,000 Lemelson MIT Prize, the world's largest cash award in invention and innovation. Kurzweil had also received the 1999 National Medal of Technology, the nation's highest honor in technology, from President Bill Clinton in a White House ceremony. Another luminary who had spoken at that Alcor conference, Gregory Benford, was an advisor to both the U.S. Department of Energy and the White House Council on Space Policy, as well as a science fiction author who had won the Nebula and John W. Campbell Awards and the 1990 United Nations Medal in Literature. Yet another speaker and Alcor advisor was Aubrey de Grey of the University of Cambridge, one of the world's leading researchers on anti-aging. These people were all at the top of their fields. I was hugely impressed. There sure were a lot of world-famous scientists a hell of a lot smarter than me lending their names and reputations to Alcor. And the cryobiological research I could be part of at CCR seemed both thrilling and important. Okay, I thought. I'd visit Alcor and withhold any judgment on the mysterious cryonics part of the job until I had seen the place. All in all, I thought, what a lively, exciting, rewarding field to be a part of. Chapter 2. Just another research facility outside Phoenix. In the United States of 2003, the days of breezing into an airport 30 minutes before departure were over. My flight to Phoenix was scheduled to leave at 10:15 a.m. 7 in the morning found me already arriving at the airport. This was a Saturday, only a few days after New Year's Day, and even 16 months after the horror of 9/11, security at Las Vegas's McCarran Airport was very tight. In the terminal, frustrated people queued up in long lines. Open your luggage, empty your carry-on, take off your belt, take off your shoes, lift up your arms, step over there. It took me 2 hours to get through check-in and the various security procedures. This put me at the Southwest Airlines gate an hour before the departure time for my flight to Phoenix. Young National Guardsmen were everywhere with combat boots and M16s. Flying has never bothered me. For 6 years during the 1990s, I worked as a flight paramedic for a large emergency helicopter service based out of the Methodist Medical Center in the Oak Cliff area of Dallas, Texas. That's where the movie theater is, where Lee Harvey Oswald hid out after shooting JFK. It's also the hometown of my favorite guitarist, Stevie Ray Vaughan. Eventually, I became flight program director for another Dallas helicopter service. I have responded to hundreds of calls as a helicopter paramedic, maybe 1,000. I was the chief flight paramedic at Waco, Texas, called in by the ATF to chopper out injured agents during the Branch Davidian siege. I've had my share of bumpy rides. And flying Southwest was far safer than riding my Harley down half the streets in North Vegas. Still, I was anxious. Forget about the German shepherds and teenage guardsmen with automatic weapons inside the airport. I was nervous before I even left home. I'm not real good at job interviews. I can take charge of a bloody accident scene with body parts strewn across a freeway, but put me in a chair and start asking me about my accomplishments and hobbies, and I start stuttering and sweating. The cold temperature sciences may very well be a lively and exciting field to be a part of, but I have seen corpses down in the Nevada desert for hours that had more color in their faces than Charles Platt's did. He was sickly looking, with sunken eyes and a yellow discoloration to his skin. He also trembled constantly. The paramedic in me registered that this man wasn't getting all the nutrients he needed. Charles Platt seemed like a hepatitis-positive fish whose gills were flapping their last gasps on land. A crudely drawn sign quivered in Charles's jaundiced hands. The words resembled my name enough for me to recognize it, but the sign looked like it had been scribbled by a disturbed, messy child. Charles's eyes darted around as if on the lookout for danger. He turned slowly, the way a man 20 years older would, and introduced a man he was with as our chief financial officer and vice president, Michael Riskin. If meeting Charles Platt made me want to run and fetch the man a wheelchair and an IV, meeting Michael Riskin made me want to run and fetch a cop. Riskin was just about the sleaziest-looking person I had ever met. He easily could have made a living bouncing around the various Law and Order and CSI shows playing Criminal Number One. Riskin seemed older than Platt, between 60 and 65. He was of medium height, with a spare tire around his belly. His hair was greasy black, streaked with gray.
his face coarse and covered in pockmarks. I'm a big Rolling Stones fan, and it struck me that Michael Riskin looked a bit like Keith Richards, only rougher. Riskin out-Keithed Keith, if that's possible. Though respectively sickly and greasy-looking, Charles Platt and Michael Riskin both greeted me with warm smiles and were very pleasant. I've learned not to judge people based on their appearances. Both men wanted me to feel welcome and comfortable, and I appreciated that. They led me outside the Phoenix Sky Harbor Airport to the Alcor vehicle, a late 1990s Chevy Suburban. I noticed a Boston Red Sox license plate on the front bumper. Interesting. That was Ted Williams's team. Charles took the wheel while Riskin sat in the passenger seat. As a driver, passenger, or bouncing body in the back, I'd gone off the road in a rocketing ambulance a few times. I'd crash-landed inside stalled helicopters that fell out of the sky like bricks. It took a lot to scare me, but still, no experience inside a moving vehicle had terrified me as much as that car ride with Charles Platt. Before we even left the parking lot, Charles was driving like a maniac. He drove way too fast. His hands, and thus the wheel and the whole car, vibrated and jerked as we raced along. I kept my silence. First impressions and all. I felt I couldn't just say, "Hi, I'm here for the job, and by the way, why are you driving like a lunatic?" In the passenger seat, Riskin was perfectly calm. I couldn't believe it. Maybe he was so used to driving with Charles, he was completely desensitized. We made an odd threesome, Charles tearing the hell out of the road and trembling like a 90-year-old palsy sufferer, Riskin serenely gazing out the passenger window, and me in the back seat, hanging on for dear life, trying to remember the last time I went to church. Charles made light, "How was your flight?" chit-chat. Camelback Mountain was inching by. I talked about my dad living near Phoenix and how much I loved the landscape, how much I wanted to live there. It was true. I did love the Phoenix area, especially north of the city. Charles went on and on about how glad they were to see me and how they needed a professional like me to help Alcor interact with hospital staff and other medical professionals. After 20 white-knuckled minutes of high-speed near misses, we arrived at the Alcor facility in Scottsdale. Overall, Phoenix is very pretty and clean, but Scottsdale is like the Beverly Hills of Phoenix, even prettier, even cleaner. There's a lot of money in Scottsdale. Alcor's facility was located in a huge industrial park southeast of the small Scottsdale airport. Nestled between light industrial businesses that didn't need walk-in traffic to survive, like the furniture reupholsterer on one side. There was uniformity in the single-story architecture, anonymity in the stucco facades. The only feature that distinguished one front from the next was which particular shade of soft blue, rusty red, or adobe orange each was painted. Alcor's front was light blue, with tidy desert landscaping composed of rocks, gravel, short prickly shrubs, and lonely cactus plants. In fact, Alcor's building at 7895 East Tacoma Drive was, if anything, special in that it was not special at all. From the outside, it was just another business. The main front door was glass, darkened to the point of being opaque. On the upper right-hand corner of the building, printed in dark blue letters, was the simple word, Alcor. If I didn't know what Alcor stood for, I wouldn't have had the foggiest idea what went on behind that dark door. I wasn't the only one thankful that our drive was over. Charles became noticeably relaxed as we walked up the concrete path and approached the door. He and Riskin both seemed relieved to be back at home base. Charles pulled out a set of keys to unlock the door. He may have been calmer than he was back in the airport, but his hands were still trembling as if he had just downed a triple shot of espresso. I noticed two cameras perched in high corners of the building, aimed down at the front yard. As Charles opened the door, a buzzer went off. No one's going to sneak up on these fellows, I thought. I followed them into the building and noticed a couple of rows of 8x10 photographs mounted on the wall to my left. There were probably 20 of them in total, some in color, others in black and white. I asked Charles about the pictures. He told me these were some of the people in cryonic suspension here at Alcor. Unlike most Alcor members, these were allowing Alcor to disclose their identities for the purposes of publicity and recruitment. The reality of what Alcor did struck me. These people's bodies were frozen somewhere in this building in the hopes of one day being revived. What kind of people signed up for that? I studied the pictures. Many of the photos were of smiling, pleasant-looking elderly people. Some were old wedding pictures. Others were yellowing portraits of military men in uniform. One young man with long, curly hair was holding a bass guitar. Charles pointed him out as if he was famous, but I didn't know the name. Randall Robertson. Charles told me Randall had suffered from several illnesses after contracting AIDS from a blood transfusion. Beneath each photograph was a brass plate engraved with dates, like on a tombstone, 1962 to 1998 and such. Underneath those numbers were the words, First Life Cycle. I asked Charles what that meant. Charles smiled and explained that Alcor did not consider these people dead. They had simply finished their first life cycle. Now Alcor was looking after them until they could be reanimated into their second life cycle. They weren't deceased. They were merely suspended. Alcor referred to them as patients. Each brass plate also had the letter A engraved on it, followed by a four-digit number, such as A2051. Once a person was awarded full membership at Alcor, Charles said, he or she was assigned one of those A numbers. The A stood for Alcor. The following four digits were the cryonics equivalent of a social security number. Charles indicated that the number would follow the person around for hundreds of years. Most Alcorians, as he called them, valued their privacy. Those who did not wish their names to be made public were referred to only by their A number. One of the pictures was of a very severe-looking Middle Eastern man whose name was listed as FM2030. I asked Charles what FM stood for. Future Man, Charles said. That's his name. Future Man thought he'd be reanimated by the year 2030 so he could enjoy his 100th birthday, hence the number. But something had caught my eye on top of the short divider wall in front of me. At first, it looked like a trophy, but then... Cool, I thought. An Emmy Award. I went straight for it. I had never seen one in person and wanted to check it out. It had been awarded to a Dick Clare for writing on the Carol Burnett Show in 1978. Charles smiled paternally like he took vicarious pleasure in Dick's accomplishments. I looked over at Riskin. He also flashed me a proud smile. Charles said Alcor was looking after Dick's Emmy Award until the day he would reanimate and reclaim it. Noticing the impression the Emmy Award had on me, Charles started rattling off a list of what he claimed were celebrity Alcor members, including Larry Flint and his late wife, Althea, casino zillionaire Don Laughlin, and Walter Matthau's son, Charlie. Timothy Leary had been a member until just before his death. Peter Sellers and Walt Disney had both expressed interest to Alcor's cryonic predecessors, and, Charles claimed, Michael Jackson had made contact with Alcor as well. That was quite a lineup. The Emmy was blanketed in a layer of dust, and I thought, you might want to clean that off before Dick reanimates. There was a fax machine and Xerox copier behind the short divider wall, and the only spots on those machines not covered in dust were the buttons, which were smudgy with black fingerprints. I noticed stacks of teetering boxes in the corners of the room. I left my handprints in the dust next to the Emmy as I turned away from the divider wall.
Riskin excused himself and disappeared down a hallway. Charles led me to a small glass table in the middle of the lobby. We sat down opposite each other. Charles told me that Alcor was very protective about his procedures. Other cryonics organizations were jealous, he said, and would love to get their hands on Alcor's secret formulas. The less outsiders knew about what went on inside Alcor, the better. I was being given a very unique opportunity, Charles told me. Charles outlined the history of Alcor to me, elaborating on the techniques they used to cryoprotect their patients. I was struck by how well-spoken Charles was on the subject of cryonics. In this area, he seemed like a real smart guy. I was distracted, though, by the clutter on the tabletop. In particular, my eye was drawn to a Domino's pizza box sitting on the table between us. It was too early for lunch, so unless folks around Alcor ordered pizza for breakfast, that box had been sitting there overnight at least. The glass tabletop was Fingerprint City, covered with crumbs, dust, and greasy smudges. I didn't see any napkins. Instead, there were several computer magazines smeared with tomato sauce scattered willy-nilly around the table. It's a good thing their patients are dead before they get wheeled in, I mused, half expecting to see a cockroach saunter across the table picking pepperoni out of its teeth. Charles didn't excuse the mess. There was no quick, embarrassed expression of, "Sorry, but we're awfully busy around here, so this must be SOP. No big deal, though. I chalked it up to these guys being the absent-minded genius types. Riskin entered the lobby with another man trailing behind him. I stood up as Riskin introduced me to Alcor's president and CEO, Dr. Jerry Lemler. A little short and a little pudgy, Jerry had thin graying hair and a thick graying beard that hung 3 or 4 inches below his chin. He wore dark-framed glasses and appeared to be in his early 50s. With his eyes cast down over his belly and toward the floor, Jerry Lemler greeted me with a very timid, "Hello." My grandfather used to tell me you can judge a man's character by his handshake. If that was true, Alcor President and CEO Dr. Jerry Lemler might have been the weakest man alive. Charles cut short the small talk, suggesting we begin my tour of the facility. Riskin agreed, and the two boxed Lemler right out of our little tour group. Trailing behind the three of us now, Lemler quietly suggested that maybe we could all grab lunch before they took me back to the airport. Without looking back, Charles said, "Maybe, if we have time, Jerry." It was clear to me that these two didn't respect or like Lemler, and that they sure didn't want him accompanying us on the tour. The stiff arm to Lemler was so well choreographed, I thought, that Platt and Riskin must have done it to him before. If Lemler noticed the slight, he didn't speak up. Charles led me down a hallway, then another, deep into the belly of Alcor. The facility was large, and I quickly became disoriented. Charles began the tour by showing me the Alcor operating room. The OR was square, about 25 feet per side. The walls were painted a clinical white. It looked like a typical small surgical suite, except for the hard white plastic mortician's table crouched in the middle of the room where a standard operating table would normally be. That seemed appropriate, since this was a room dedicated to operating on, well, dead people. Unlike standard operating tables, mortician's tables have high walls on both sides to funnel blood down and away from the body during autopsies. 2 large surgical lights towered above. They were harsh, "Where were you on the night of August 16th?" type lights. As I stood at the foot of the mortician's table, I glanced to my left and noticed several roller pumps, commonly used in hospital surgical suites to pump blood or medicine through the body. To the immediate left of the mortician's table was a clear box made of what looked like plexiglass, about 2.5 feet square. Clear piping led away from it, down to a large tank of liquid nitrogen. Inside the box was a piece of metal hardware I recognized as a halo, which physicians used to stabilize patients with neck injuries. The patient's head is placed inside the halo, and then screws are tightened to the point where they make contact with the skull, immobilizing the head and stabilizing the neck. It looks like a medieval torture device, but is very effective. What puzzled me about this particular halo was that it was embedded inside the small plexiglass box. Where does the rest of the patient go? I asked Charles about the setup. He told me it was their cephalic isolation box.
Cephalic, as in cephalon? I asked.
Charles nodded. Most patients wish to have only their heads cryo-suspended, Charles said, so Alcor hired a retired local surgeon to come in and decapitate them. Then the head, or cephalon, was placed into that plexiglass box and perfused with a special formula of drugs while liquid nitrogen was simultaneously pumped in. This began the cooling process.
A little macabre, to be sure, but I thought it was fascinating.
That cephalic isolation box was ingenious. I asked who had designed it. It wasn't only Charles's hands that trembled. Now his lips were twitching. The way Charles next said, "Our facilities engineer, Hugh Hickson," was enough to suggest there wasn't much love lost between Charles and Hickson. Looking at that box, though, I could tell this Hugh Hickson guy was one heck of a creative engineer. To envision the design of that box, amass the unrelated parts, build it, and then actually make it work, that was brilliant. My appreciation of Hugh Hickson's work seemed to speed up Charles's tour. Apart from the door we had entered, there were three others leading out of the OR. One led down a short hallway to a restroom, another led to a small storeroom, and the third led to the lab area. Given the state of the front reception area, I opted not to visit Alcor's bathroom. I told Charles I didn't have to hit the cephalon just yet, but he didn't laugh. Trembling, Charles broke out his keys once more and unlocked the storeroom door. Its shelves were packed full with hospital supplies. In fact, Alcor seemed better stocked than many major hospital emergency rooms I had worked in. Apparently, money wasn't an issue where supplies were concerned. There was everything in there, from sutures to syringes, needles to scalpels. I recognized a vaginal speculum on one of the shelves, an instrument used by gynecologists. I couldn't imagine why they needed one of those at Alcor. There were also intravenous solutions with use-by dates that, curiously, had expired years before. We entered what Alcor called the dry lab. Like the front lobby, the dry lab was cluttered with cardboard boxes. Whatever. Einstein was a slob, right? Black plastic Pelican storage cases, popular among campers and survivalists because they are watertight and sturdy, were stacked to the ceiling. Charles told me they stored all of their transport team equipment in the Pelican cases. I asked if I could look inside. Charles appeared happy that I was taking an interest. He chose one and opened it. Inside were at least 50 Ziploc bags filled with vials of drugs. The bags were numbered with a red marker, 1, 2, 3, etc. When I asked Charles why the bags were numbered this way, he told me that most of their emergency transport team members were volunteers. These were the people who went to hospitals and homes when Alcor members had deanimated to begin the suspension process. Though they were all dedicated Alcorians, Charles said, they were not trained medical personnel. He joked that most of them had no idea how to pronounce the names of the drugs in those baggies, never mind what they were used for. Alcor had found it easier to simply label the bags and instruct the volunteers to inject the drugs in numerical order. Meanwhile, Riskin was poking around the insides of the Pelican case quizzically. It was obvious that he, like the average Alcor volunteer, did not know much about the contents. I examined several of these baggies. Oddly, I noticed that all of the drugs were expired, just like the intravenous solutions back in the storeroom. I thought to myself, I wonder if the FDA or DEA would have a problem with these drugs being expired. Then again, these drugs are being administered into the deceased, so But wait, if Alcor considers their patients to be alive, shouldn't they provide drugs that haven't expired and thus lost their potency? It was a wild circle of logic. I wondered which government agencies oversaw these types of organizations. Frankly, the frontiers of science mystique really intrigued me. Somehow, despite all the oddities I was encountering and a few early alarm bells, I was sort of digging this place. We made our way through another door into the wet lab. There was a large restaurant-style sink divided into three basins with a water sprayer dangling over it. Opposite the silver sink were several industrial-sized refrigerators with stainless steel doors. Everything was sheathed in reflective metal, very futuristic-looking. Charles opened one of the refrigerators and said this was where Alcor kept its temperature-sensitive drugs. I stuck my head into the cold. Again, most of the drugs were expired. I also noticed several metal trays full of a drug called Diprovan. Coincidentally, this was the same drug that early press reports said was found in Michael Jackson's home after his death in June 2009. Diprovan is a milky white liquid, usually kept in 20-milliliter glass containers. It is a sedative hypnotic agent. It puts someone out, but not totally out, sedating them and at the same time clouding their memory so they don't remember anything. But what does a company whose patients are already pronounced dead by the time they get them into their OR need with a drug that sedates them and then fogs their memory? As Charles was shutting the refrigerator door, something else caught my eye. "Wait," I said, "why do you have that?" Charles closed the refrigerator door, muttering something about pharmacology being out of his element. Riskin seemed to be intently studying his shoes. I had made Charles nervous, and now I was sensing that he was by nature a paranoid person. I didn't want to push it, but I remained curious about what I had seen. The drug I had noticed was called vecuronium, a musculoskeletal paralytic, another powerful drug used by physicians, especially anesthesiologists, as well as senior paramedics. In the field, vecuronium is indicated for patients who need to be intubated. That's when a tube is placed directly into the trachea to help a patient breathe. When vecuronium is administered, the patient becomes paralyzed within seconds. This allows the physician or paramedic to intubate the trachea without the patient choking, gagging, vomiting, and fighting like hell to the point of endangering himself. As you can imagine, being intubated while conscious is a horrific experience. The drugs used as paralytics must be highly potent. In the wrong hands, though, vecuronium is deadly. During my tenure as a paramedic, I had had to administer vecuronium to dozens of patients, and it scared me sick every time. If you inject someone with vecuronium and then do not have the equipment and training to breathe for them immediately, you've killed them. The fact that Alcor stored sedatives was curious, but paralytics? What would a company that deals with dead people need with drugs that will stop a patient from breathing within seconds of being administered? Charles turned to me, clasping his hands together in a trembling image of prayer, and asked, "Would you like to see where we keep our patients?" It was the icing on the cake, so to speak. Isn't that what everyone on this tour really wanted to see? "Step this way to the coolers, folks, just past the gift shop." We walked back through the OR, past a set of wall lockers, down a hallway, and arrived at a door. This place was a maze. Charles flipped on a light and announced that we were standing in the cool-down bay. There was a large ice machine against the wall. Well, that made sense. Charles explained that after a patient's head was removed, perfused with Alcor's cryoprotectant chemicals, and initially cooled in the OR's cephalic isolation box, they drilled two burr holes into the skull and slid in microphones to monitor the brain with a computer rig they called the crack phone. A hook-type handle was installed into the neck for easier handling. From that point on, they carried the patient's head around, upside down, like a bowling ball bag. The head was then lugged into the cooldown bay and lowered into a waist-high cylindrical cooling tank called the LR-40. They used duct tape to seal the LR-40's lid, and then liquid nitrogen was pumped in for the cooldown to minus 321 degrees Fahrenheit. Before I could ask about the ominous-sounding crack phone, Charles fumbled with his keys once more and unlocked the gray door at the opposite end of the room. I noticed another camera overhead, pointing down at the door.
"Here it is," Charles announced. "The patient care bay. This is where the patients reside."
I have never in my life been the jumpy type, but I almost went through the damn ceiling when I heard the thin, shrill voice call out from beyond the door.
"Who's there?"
"It's Charles, and I'm not alone."
Charles walked through the door. I followed. As I entered the patient care bay, a figure appeared. I would have believed it if I were told right then that one of Alcor's patients had reanimated and was making a break for it. Dr. R. Michael Perry was skinny, malnutrition skinny. He reminded me of pictures I'd seen of POWs. He had his arms crossed in front of him, hugging himself, long fingers clutching bony elbows. His hair stood out at odd angles, unkempt and messy. Together with his rumpled, dirty clothes, Mike Perry gave me the impression that he had just gotten out of bed. It was hard to estimate Mike's true height because he stood slumped over due to his hunched back. It seemed a little too perfect, a little too Igor, but it was the God's honest truth that Mike Perry, the Alcor employee who looked after the frozen patients, was hunchbacked. Introducing us, Charles told me that Mike was a mathematician and held multiple degrees, including a PhD in computer science. He was, Charles smilingly said, a genius. Despite the praise, Mike just lowered his head and scurried out of the room, mumbling, "I will say, for an emaciated brainiac who walked with his arms folded, Mike made good time. He was unnaturally fast and stealthy, like a lab rat that was successfully endowed with superhuman intelligence and then picked the lock on the cage. Mike was, to say the least, an eccentric guy." As the muttering trailed off down the hallway, Charles told me Mike's title was caretaker of the patient care bay. I spotted a blue container on the right side of the room that resembled a big freezer chest. Mostly, though, it looked like something Dr. Frankenstein would have kept in his basement to lock up his failed experiments. The chest was wrapped in a thick padded chain with a heavy padlock. A confusion of wires snaked out from under its lid and ran down to some sort of electronic hub, which in turn was connected to a computer. The computer monitor displayed a graph with straight lines running through it, like an electrocardiogram monitor. Attached to one of the wires coming out of the freezer chest was a pale yellow tag with A1949 written on it in black marker. I recalled the A numbers I had seen under the photos on the Alcor Wall of Fame. Actually, another A number had been blackened out with a magic marker, and A1949 had been written beneath the crossed-out number. Recycling the tags identifying their patients' heads? I thought. They must have one damn thrifty comptroller. I asked Charles about the container. Placing one hand on the computer monitor and leaning up against the table in frustration, Charles sighed. He explained that the Cryostar was a high-tech intermediate temperature storage unit where patients' heads were sometimes stored midway through the freezing process. The Cryostar was intended to afford extra careful protection while a head underwent drastic drops in temperature. The Cryostar was giving them problems, though. Charles explained that it was designed to maintain a constant temperature down around minus 126 degrees Celsius, minus 196 degrees Fahrenheit. This was supposed to limit cracking the patient's brain, but the Cryostar was malfunctioning, randomly fluctuating plus or minus 10 degrees. Relatively speaking, this was a huge temperature swing.
"Sorry, Charles, did you say cracking the patient's brain?"
"Unfortunately, that happens," Charles said. There are two heads in the cryostar right now, he continued. One had been a close personal friend of his. The other was patient A-1949. And over here, Larry, are the doers. Charles turned my attention to a half-dozen tall, shiny metal canisters lining the left side of the room. They were highly polished reflective steel, standing more than 10 feet tall and about 5 feet in diameter. I saw my face mirrored in them, all skewed and unreal, like in a funhouse mirror. Each sported a giant Alcor logo. The doers looked like something out of a 1980s science fiction movie. Charles was reverential as he discussed them. The way he gushed over them, they were evidently the pride and joy of Alcor. I looked around for Riskin, to note his attitude toward the tall silver tubes, but he had disappeared. Charles went into great detail about the Dewars. I learned that the name originated with Sir James Dewar, the 19th century Scottish chemist and physicist, best known for his work with low-temperature phenomena. He was a professor of experimental natural philosophy at the University of Cambridge, England, in 1875, and then professor of chemistry at the Royal Institution of Great Britain in 1877, where he was appointed director of the Davy Faraday Research Laboratory. Wow! It was as if Charles had swallowed a memory chip. He had this Tor spiel down cold. The Dewar bottle was a container for storing extremely hot or cold substances. It consisted of two flasks, one inside the other, separated by a vacuum. The vacuum greatly reduced the transfer of heat, preventing a temperature change. The walls were usually made of glass because it was a poor conductor of heat, and its surfaces were lined with reflective metal to reduce the transfer of heat by radiation. Sir James's containers were most famously used in the distilling of Scotch whiskey. Alcor, however, put them to quite a different use. Bizarre as this seems now in the retelling, I learned that at Alcor, each doer housed either four whole-body patients or a combination of whole bodies and severed heads. At the time, I was simply fascinated by the engineering behind it. Charles explained that before being placed in a doer, a full-body patient was deposited into a sleeping bag and then suspended upside down in a pod made of sheet metal. The pod was about 7 feet tall and wedge-shaped, made to a measurement 1/4 of the inside diameter of a doer. If one stood on a ladder and looked straight down onto a doer with the lid off, Charles said, you would see the tops of four triangular pods, like looking down on a pizza with four slices. I had to chuckle at Charles's metaphor. It must have been deep-dish pizza. The reason whole-body patients were placed upside down was to help protect their brains. If something catastrophic happened and there was a massive liquid nitrogen leak, the patients' heads would be the last things exposed. Made sense. I asked how many suspended patients they had in total. Charles told me the number was in the 50s. They had designed this room very carefully. The south wall was 2 feet thick, concrete reinforced with steel. These walls were built, Charles said, so that no one could drive a car through them in case someone tried to break in to harm or steal the patients. I asked about the smaller, squat silver tank on the back wall. This was the neuro vault, Charles explained. After they lifted the patient's fully cooled head from the LR-40 cooling tank, they placed it into a stainless steel container called a neuro can. It looked like a lobster pot to me. And that pot was placed inside the neuro vault for temporary storage. The doers were the final destination for long-term storage, but it was better to open them as infrequently as possible, Charles said. It was a big, delicate job opening the doers. There was a crane permanently mounted on the roof to muscle those big canisters around. Heads were stored in the neuro vault until they absolutely had to open a doer. Charles said they also stored samples of their patients' DNA in the neuro vault, as well as some cat and dog heads. Cat and dog heads? Some members want to have their pets with them when they are reanimated into their next life cycle, Charles said.
Charles wasn't sure, but he thought there was a monkey brain in there, too.
So, Charles said, clapping his hands together, that's the tour. Hungry for lunch?
Charles had zero perspective on exactly how funny that question sounded. After 25 years as a paramedic, I didn't exactly have a weak stomach where body parts were concerned. The casual way Charles talked about all this, though, was just plain odd. Still, I was impressed with his knowledge and dedication to cryonics.
Lead on, Charles, I thought. Decapitated TV writers and monkey brains always perk up my appetite.
As we left the patient care bay, I noticed Mike Perry hugging himself and watching me from underneath the camera in the neighboring cool-down bay. At some point during Charles's explanation of the doers, Perry must have crept back in there to study me. Charles noticed and said,
Mike is real protective of our patients.
I followed Charles through many twists and turns back to the front lobby. On my own, I was sure I would have had a hard time finding the way out. Riskin and Lemler were silently waiting at the table, still adorned with the empty pizza box. I looked over at the wall of pictures. Those pleasant folks were in the doers now, residing between animations. I looked at bassist Randall Robertson. For some reason, I pictured an Alcor technician shaving off those long, curly locks. They'd do that, right? Before they chopped off his head? Otherwise, I figured his hair would have shattered when it was brought down to minus 321 degrees Fahrenheit. At lunch, we talked about my background as a paramedic. Jerry Lemler was very interested in hearing about basic emergency medicine techniques. Charles and Riskin were more interested in hearing about my experiences as chief helicopter paramedic at Waco during the siege of the Branch Davidian complex. People usually shook their heads in horror and disbelief when I told stories about the Waco siege. Charles Platt and Michael Riskin had a different attitude, though. They told me they admired the Branch Davidians for holding fast to their beliefs and standing up to the U.S. government. I had held the brains of ATF officers in my hand, American heroes who took 50-caliber rounds to the head from fanatical cult members ready to kill and die for their messianic leader. I had dealt with the Davidians firsthand, zealots who considered themselves prisoners of war, including their poor brainwashed children. After encountering the Branch Davidians personally, I didn't find anything in them to admire or emulate. I told Riskin and Platt exactly that. They nodded solemnly and said they respected my feelings. Charles wanted to hear my thoughts on how to organize the Alcor emergency teams into more professional groups. They seemed aware that they all gave off an odd sense to outsiders. That's where they seemed to hope I'd come in. They needed someone like me as a bridge to the mainstream medical community. First of all, I suggested they change the title of the job, transport team leader, they were interviewing me for. I told them that hospital personnel weren't familiar with the title, and it would give them pause. Better to call the job Director of Clinical Services. Every hospital and ambulance company had a job with this title. It was a title doctors and nurses in an ICU would understand.
Done, Jerry said.
The other two nodded their heads. Next, I asked if the volunteers had any sort of uniform or name tags identifying them as Alcor employees. In order to work in the medical community, you really need to look the part. By nature, hospital administrators are a hard-boiled, suspicious lot. They see a lot of shenanigans. You can't walk into a hospital wearing street clothes, carrying all kinds of equipment, and then ask to take possession of a deceased patient you are not even related to. You will not get a warm reception. In fact, with all the recent fears of terrorism and with babies being stolen out of nurseries, I told them, hospitals were now monitored more closely than ever. Platt told me they had already thought of that. Alcor volunteers, he said, have made name tags that read, Organ Recovery Team. I sat back in my chair in disbelief. Lemler and Riskin kept right on eating.
Can't do that, I said.
In no uncertain terms, I told them they were going to get into a lot of trouble. That was misrepresentation, plain and simple. Organ recovery teams were trained professionals with a wide range of licenses and certifications. That would be like me walking into a hospital with a name tag reading Larry Johnson, M.D. I didn't go to school for that. I didn't earn that. If ICU nurses struck up a conversation with these cryonicists, they would figure out pretty quickly they were not real organ recovery personnel. Dressing up your volunteers to look professional is one thing. Misrepresentation is something else and completely wrong. If Alcor's volunteers were caught impersonating an organ recovery team, I told them, they wouldn't be allowed into another hospital in the country. Period. The three of them looked at each other, shocked, not knowing what to say. Finally, Jerry stammered something about that's exactly why they needed someone like me at Alcor, someone who knew how to interact with the medical community. Okay, I thought. So at least they do want to clean up their act, professionally speaking. Charles changed the subject. If I took the job, he explained, I would be free to pursue my own interests in cold temperature research with their sister facility, Critical Care Research, in Rancho Cucamonga, California. That sounded fantastic to me. I told them that was probably the biggest reason I was interested in the job. Jerry told me I would have all of CCR's resources at my disposal and plenty of time to participate in their current projects or pursue my own research. I thought about that road treatment for ice storms. It sounded like awfully fulfilling work. I would also be asked to train Alcor volunteers on emergency medical procedures, Charles said, and I'd assist their emergency response teams transporting patients from their place of deanimation to the Alcor facility. I'd help prepare the bodies, administering drugs and assisting in the washout procedure in which the member's blood was replaced by Alcor's cryopreservant chemicals. Then I would lend a hand in the OR during the final phases of cryosuspension. I was intrigued, actually, wondering what all this really entailed. I guess more than a director of clinical services, I'd be a paramedic to the dead, I joked. They all stopped chewing. Oh no, Larry, Jerry Lemler said. Those patients aren't dead. They're deanimated, awaiting their second life cycle. On the way to the airport, Charles flat out asked me for a commitment. Just like that. I already knew they were offering an employment and pay package just about equal to what I was used to as a paramedic, but without the daily physical pounding. I told Charles the truth. Alcor was definitely new, exciting, and fascinating, thus extremely appealing to a guy like me, but I would have to talk it over with Beverly. We pulled up to the curb at Sky Harbor Airport. I leaned across the seat, took hold of Charles's shivering yellow trout of a hand, and told him I would call him later. He said he'd be looking forward to it. Without looking back, I shut the door and walked into the terminal. Once inside that airport, damn if I didn't just sprint to the nearest bar and order a vodka martini. My brain was buzzing. The unhealthy look of the Alcorians stuck out to me, from the trembling COO to the hunchbacked keeper of the dead. Patients, life cycles, deanimation, A-1949, the heads in the cryostar, the bodies in the dewars, the DNA samples in the neurovault, floating on top of the cat heads and monkey brains, the cephalic isolation box, fractured brains and crack phones, the dust, the pizza box, the paralytic drugs, the vaginal speculum. Vaginal speculum? Man, what a day! As soon as I got home, I grabbed Beverly, rushed her to one of our favorite restaurants, and blabbed about my Scottsdale adventure for 2 hours straight. Bev let me get it all out with only the occasional intelligent question. She's a great listener, one of the many things I've always loved about her. As I relived the day's events with her, I realized how excited I was by the prospect of working at Alcor. Pioneering research on the furthest edge of modern biotech with brilliant, albeit eccentric, colleagues. During a pause in my story, Beverly said, "You're really excited about this," and it sounds like maybe this is another type of adrenaline rush for you. Maybe you're trading the danger and excitement of paramedicine for this strange, fascinating world of cryonics. I smiled at her. She knew me. She was right. Is that bad? I asked. Beverly laughed and said, At this point, anything that gets you off the street as a paramedic is okay with me. They were some strange birds, these Alcorians. But bizarre as they were, what if they were really onto something? I mean, we're talking about immortality. They told me I would be...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.